The show I'm about to talk about was so amazing that I literally continue to get shivers down my spine just reading the name of it.
Well, fuck you, loser! Is this what you were trying to do?
I was trying to cut it clean off. It was gonna be rad.
On October 24th, 2019, a show called Daybreak graced the Netflix streaming platform. However, I didn't pay attention to it because I thought it was just gonna be, well, stupid. I don't really remember what I was binging at the time, but I thought it would for sure be better. Eventually, I finished my current show and it was on to something new. So I started browsing Netflix's catalog. As it turns out, Netflix had decided to really shove Daybreak in my face, so I caved in and finally decided to give it a go. This was one of the best decisions of my life. Never have I ever watched a more original, unique, creative, and deep show in my entire life. As soon as I got to episode 10, I, along with everybody else who watched Daybreak, was left with a major cliffhanger. So naturally, I looked up when the next season was going to arrive. Unfortunately, for all of us, I found out that it had been canceled after only 2 months after it had premiered. Netflix never even gave it a chance to get a proper fan base, and honestly, they have a really big habit of doing this, and it's pretty annoying, quite frankly. Daybreak is a show about a Canadian redhead named Josh who is trying to get back to his former girlfriend, Sam Dean, who he lost in the apocalypse in Los Angeles. In order to do this, Josh has to overcome a lot of different obstacles, such as ghoulies, other random apocalypse wastelander people, Fallout style, yada yada yada. Ghoulies are Daybreak's version of zombies, by the way. I guess they just wanted to be more original, which is great, honestly. But basically, in the beginning, there was some kind of blast, which they all call the boom, that turned all the adults into these weird things. The only thing they can say is the last thing they were thinking, which actually leads us to some pretty funny scenes with them just blabbering random stuff in the middle of a pretty intense fight sequence or something.
Or is it LaCroix? Is it LaCroix?
The remaining kids in the show all formed into cliques that represent who they rolled with in high school. For example, the Disciples of Kardashian, the 4-H Club, the Jocks, the STEM Punks, and many other smaller factions. The factions actually play a pretty big role in the show, as none of them really like outsiders, so pretty much just like high school. And of course, since it's just like high school, the Jocks are in charge because they're the strongest, and who's actually going to be able to, you know, contest them? What, the 4-H Club? No way. Daybreak provides us with a very typical stereotypical knight in shining armor protagonist who actually gives us some pretty awesome self-aware narration.
So what's life like in the apocalypse? It's never what you'd expect. What are you doing? Well, stop looking at me. Turn around.
And almost every time he's talking about Sam, he goes into excruciating lengths to explain how awesome of a person she was. However, as it turns out, Josh, our redhead protagonist, is a pretty unreliable narrator and probably the worst narrator I think I've ever witnessed in anything ever. However, Josh isn't actually our only narrator. Throughout the course of the 10 episodes Netflix provided us with, we get narration from the perspective of Matthew Bodrick's character, Principal Burr, the principal of Josh's school, obviously, because I referred to him as principal, as well as Angelica Green, a child genius, RZA, the rapper guy, who narrates for Wesley Fists, who's a self-appointed samurai, and Turbo, ironically narrates for Turbo, which is interesting because Turbo can't speak. He's the leader of the Jocks, by the way. He just, for some reason, well, I'm not gonna spoil everything, but he communicates through grunts because that's just how he talks. The interesting thing is that Angelica actually calls Josh out for being an awful narrator, which is foreshadowing the season finale and series finale, unfortunately. One thing that makes this show so great is that it's not actually just about Josh. It seems like a show that has a very central protagonist and he is the only person who matters, as most television shows' format is. However, this simply isn't the case. As we're reminded a copious amount of times, while Josh is filmed front and center, he's actually the least important person in the entire show, in my personal opinion. everything that matters happens around him, and in the end, the lesson is the straight white guy isn't always the most important character to pay attention to. However, this wasn't done in a really toxic way like Disney handles Star Wars. Daybreak successfully bamboozles its audience multiple times throughout its 10-episode run. For example, Turbo is somewhat of a self-appointed bad guy. We know there is some dude named Baron Triumph who is kinda ruling the wasteland, but for a good portion of the show, he's just a shadowy figure with no face. No one really knows who he is. Eventually, Baron Triumph captures Turbo and knocks him off his high horse. As a result, we see a very humanized version of Turbo, as well as the reveal that Baron Triumph is Ferris Bueller. Actually, I mean Principal Burr. Sorry, they're played by the same person. This was actually a pretty shocking reveal, but maybe also not so shocking when you rewatch the show. This show features constant flashbacks to life before the boom, and Burr was in a lot of them. If he wasn't dead, then why would he be there? Miss Crumble, who is a teacher, was also in the first scene ever, the first scene in the show, taking roll call in Josh's class. Later, it turns out she's the only self-aware ghoulie. So yeah, if someone seems to keep appearing in a show, they're probably pretty important. However, he did seem like such an innocent principal.
Why do you have to use words like pussy and vag and minge? What's wrong with you kids?
This is the way we talk.
That language is not in the code of conduct. Remember, Hornets, be
positive.
The show also does a really good job of depicting the LGBTQ community without sacrificing what the show is supposed to be about. It's not forced and it's not super out of context. Circling back to Turbo, when he gets captured, Wesley Fisk goes back to rescue him. Turns out the two of them were lovers, but they were going through something kinda rough before the boom happened. Anyways, Wesley was originally a jock, so it turns out, and he decided to leave Turbo once he went off the deep end. As a result, he's now a pacifist on this weird path to enlightenment. It's kind of weird considering he wields a sword and kind of acts like he's gonna fight everyone in the show, and then proceeds to say he's a samurai trying to redeem his soul and won't hurt a fly. He doesn't even help his friends when they're trapped in the cage with the ghoulie witch, who also turns out to be Miss Crumble. It doesn't matter. The point is, Wesley's kind of weird. The characters are still well written, that's what matters. Character development is definitely one of this show's major strong points. For example, earlier in the show we meet a super self-centered kid named Eli. He somehow took over an entire mall shortly after the boom happened, but won't let any of our heroes in because it's his. In episode 9, Josh vs. the Apocalypse, part 2, which is, in my opinion, incorrectly named since this really feels like more of an Eli-centric episode. I mean, come on. Eli literally does hijack one of Josh's narrations.
Yo, you can't weaponize flashbacks. That's emotional profiling.
This is just a memory of Eli. Not allowed to do this.
Says who?
It's my story.
Well, not anymore, bro. I'm jacking your narration, and I'm showing everyone just how awful you are.
Anyways, Eli and Josh start bonding over their love of Pokemon cards, and suddenly in the next shot, they turn into two kids. Just two kids talking about Pokemon cards, walking through the apocalypse, and it's honestly a pretty beautiful scene. Shortly therefore after, that was a weird way to say that, Eli disguises as Baron Triumph, as he actually does earlier in the show. Anyways, he gets jumped by a former jock named Hoyles. Eli is stabbed, killed, and this brings his character arc full circle, from him being a selfish dick to someone who actually cares about another person. I feel like I have to defend this show's honor for a second. The reason Eli's dressed up as Baron Triumph is because that's actually how he secured the mall. You find out that Eli has knockoff everythings. That was just part of his personality in high school. So he also had a knockoff Baron Triumph costume. So he used that and would patrol around once per day, and that would keep all the jocks and everyone else out of the mall. It's not bad writing. It didn't just come out of nowhere. There is one reoccurring trend with the show, and it's also the show's biggest strength, in my opinion. Every single character that is important gets at least one episode that is centered around them, and they're the narrator, at least for the flashbacks. This also includes Sam Dean, which is interesting because up until this point, we've only heard Sam's story from Josh's perspective, and by this point, I mean the point of when she gets her centric episode.
Sorry, I don't want to pity peck for our first kiss, you know?
You could be broody and bleak, but you're not. Your superpower is your honesty.
Anyways, I personally feel like Sam's episode Postmates was actually a Hidden Jaw-centric episode, as he was really in literally all of it. In episode 10, when Josh finally does save Sam, it's revealed that he knows literally nothing about Sam. The end of the show actually depicts Sam Dean becoming a dictator, just like Turbo and Baron Triumph before her. The average person might think, and did think, that this came out of nowhere, but it really didn't. The reason this happened is that Josh was an incredibly unreliable narrator. We as a viewer were forced to be just as stupid, just as dumb, and just as naive as he was. And honestly, it's beautiful. I can't think of another show that executed the unreliable narrator in such a perfect way. Usually, it's kind of established up front that this narrator sucks, so you know not to trust them. Daybreak didn't do that. We get all the way to the end, and then we're just confused. For all intents and purposes, Daybreak, as we know it, is a complete lie. If Joss was such an unreliable narrator, imagine how bad everyone else might have been. I mean, these are all just random high schoolers trying to be cool. We really have no idea what anything was like in the apocalypse, and seeing as the show got canceled, we really never will. In the end of the day, I think the main reason this show got canceled was not because it was bad, but because it was perfect, or at least very unique, and people couldn't really get behind that. Daybreak is a show about subverting your expectations while breaking the fourth wall as much as physically possible. Daybreak is a show that should change the way we all perceive what we are being told. We shouldn't just believe what is on screen because it is told to us by the main character. We should look deeper for the hidden meaning. Daybreak was ahead of its time, and I am truly disappointed that we won't get to go on this wild adventure through the post-apocalyptic version of Los Angeles in the future. So you want to know what life in the apocalypse is like? It gets canceled after one season. Hey everybody, thanks for watching. If you got to the end, you definitely deserve a gold star, or at least not to be turned into ghoulie food. If you're new here, please consider leaving a like, commenting, and subscribing. All of that support really helps us, and I will see you guys in the next one. Don't forget to, be safe. Bye.